Hello, let's talk about functions in this video. The second type of subprogram at GCSE. We've looked at procedures, we've defined the kind of overarching term, which is subprogram. Let's now look at how functions are different to procedures. So here's the difference. I've said before in a video, procedures don't return a value, functions do return a value. That is the difference between a procedure and a function. That won't make sense until we look at some examples. But even still, that difference is confusing. You might be watching knowing that difference and still being a bit confused about this. I think it helps understand the difference between the purpose of a procedure, purpose of a function, by reminding ourselves of the input process output model. We can simplify programs to just consist of inputs, processes, and outputs. At the start, we get some data, we do some processing on this data, we then output it. And typically, most of our programs get the inputs from the user with an input line, and typically we output to the user using print lines. But these aren't the only ways we can get input into a program and output from a program. We've also looked recently in this series at text files. We could read in some data from a text file and write results back to the text file. We do have other ways of inputting and outputting, even beyond these two. Well, how does that link to subprograms? Well, subprogram, tells you what they are. They are like mini programs. We can treat them like they are mini programs. So again, they have inputs, processes, and outputs. The inputs we've looked at so far are parameters. We'll also look at global variables. They can be used as well. We've got some code inside the subprogram, which is doing the processing. That's the code in our definition. And the outputs so far have only been print lines. However, we can also have returns. So a return is another type of output from a subprogram. And functions return, procedures typically just print. And we can also output via global variables again, but they are not so good. Let's look at these side by side with a question. So using radius, which is passed in via a parameter, we're using radius as an input with a parameter, we're going to define a subprogram that outputs the area of a circle. Now, I've deliberately not said what subprogram to use. I've also not said what type of output I'm using. Am I printing? Am I returning? Typically, the question would tell you, I'm just keeping it open-ended so I can show you both side by side. So on the left, we have a procedure in OCR exam reference language, and we have a function in OCR exam reference language. In Python, we use def for both definitions. So in Python, there is no easy way to see the difference apart from presence or not of the word return. So if you compare it side by side and play spot the difference, you can't see too many differences in our definition. The key one is I'm printing in my procedure and I'm returning in my function. Return doesn't need brackets because it's not a built-in subprogram, whereas print is. That is our only difference in our definitions apart from the word function and procedure. It is a little bit different when I come to call my subprograms now. So procedure, I just write the procedure name, then put brackets, and if it's got a parameter, which it does here, I put in a value to give it a value. With a function, a bit more work involved. What you should be doing is assigning the calling line to a variable. Doesn't matter what this is called. And then if you want to see it, you need to print it. So let's just unpick what I'm talking about here a little bit. So if I break this code by removing the bits, which make it a function program, not procedure, this is how we would call it if it was a procedure. What happens if I run it? I get absolutely nothing. So I have run it, the code is working. If I say printed a test line here, we would see test being shown. So it is working. However, I'm not seeing anything, and I'm not seeing anything because the key difference between return and print is shown to the user sees it on their screen, return isn't shown to the user. I like to think of return as being a bit of a secretive output. We are outputting a value from our subprogram back to our main program, but we're not telling the user about it. And this is really, really important because in a complicated program, there are so many subprograms working and a lot of them are doing jobs I don't want the user to see. I might be programming a video game and there are loads of internal workings which I don't need the user to see. On their screen, I don't want there to be a million outputs of little individual things. I want to keep those secret. I want to keep them hidden in my program. I don't need to tell the user every single thing. So we use print when I want to tell the user something. I don't always want to do that. So that's why I can use return to keep it secret. Now, I'm sort of breaking that secretive nature by, in my example, just immediately printing it. So it does seem like there is no difference at all in what I'm doing here between a procedure and a function, because I am still just printing it. However, I might choose not to print it. If I'm writing a real program, I might use this result in another subprogram or in some other bit of my code. For example, I might have a render 3D model procedure which can take in a result, which is the area of a circle, and it might generate a 3D sphere on the screen. That might be part of a video game, for example. I don't need the user to see 78.55. I want the user to see that nice 3D sphere. That's why I would use return and not print. So I admit that GCSE, it doesn't seem very useful, but really functions are used more than procedures in real life because we don't want to tell the user every single thing. However, this should be your structure. We should call it, we should assign it to a variable, and then print it. So what's happening when this code runs, and if I change my parameter to get some different values, what's happening is we get lines 1 to 6, like procedures, are effectively ignored initially. It just notes that it's got a function called circle area. It doesn't run it. It only runs it when it's actually called. So in line 7, we are assigning the variable result to be the output from circle area with a value 8. So when it sees this bit here, the calling line, it jumps up, runs the code up here, and when it sees return, it jumps back down to where it was and basically replaces the calling line with whatever was returned from our subprogram, which in this particular case was this number here. Then we can print it like normal. We are really replacing our calling line with whatever was returned. I've got my procedure code back here just to show you an example again of why functions can be more useful potentially, not always, but potentially. Here is a procedure. Well, I'm running it, I'm getting 78.55, but maybe I would rather print out 78.55 followed by centimeters squared or something like that. But I could do that here. However, it means every single time I call this procedure, it is going to say centimeters squared. And maybe it is not always going to be centimeters squared. It could sometimes be meters squared or even kilometers squared. I don't always want centimeters squared in my output. So I'm in a difficult situation where I want it sometimes, but not always. Well, with a function, I get a lot more versatility. In the same way that parameters gave us more versatility, returning gives us more versatility as well. Because if I want sometimes centimeters squared to get outputted, that's perfectly fine. I can just use the resulting variable to output it. Another time, I might not want to do that. I might have a second result with a different parameter value. This time, I'm happy just to print out the result without any unit. So I get more versatility because it's giving me the value to do what I want with it. As soon as it's output to the user, like in a procedure, I can't then use a value again. It's gone. And the last thing I'll just point out about return, which can catch people out, and you see sometimes some errors in answers if people don't quite understand this. Return should be the last thing we put inside a function, as in we should not have any lines which come after return, because the second it sees return, it is going to end and jump back down to the original line. Now, the word return is returning back to where it was. Nothing will be done after that point. So the test line here will never, ever, 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 ever run because it's coming after a return. Whereas if I was making this effectively a procedure, we would be able to do multiple prints in a row because they're not going anywhere. Return does cause it to end early. So be careful about that. Always put it last. Let's have a look at another couple of examples because this is relatively tricky to get your head around. So we need to write a function called adder that has two parameters, num1 and num2. It needs to return the sum of num1 and num2. And we're going to call this function with the values 5 and 10 and print out the total. We know it should be a function because it says function multiple times, but also if it says anything about returning, it's telling you, it's screaming at you that it is a function, not a procedure. So let's do this in ERL like I've been doing in all my videos. So we write the word function, first of all. In Python, it'd be def, but it's function in ERL. And I've got to give this a name. It's actually told me the name should be adder. That is my identifier for my function. I haven't put brackets. I've got two parameters, num1, num2. Now, what needs to go inside my function? Well, really, this could be a one line function, because all I need to do is add up num1 and num2. Not rocket science to do this normally. How am I going to package it in a return line? Well, I simply can just write the word return and then follow it with num1 plus num2. I'm going to return the sum of num1 and num2. You could do a variable like sum equals num1 plus num2, return sum, but we can make it in one line here, so why not do that? That's it for my definition. I can now just do end function. And we do need to call it. Some questions won't require you to call it. Only call it if you are actually asked to. Don't volunteer more work. We are asked to here. Let's call it with the values 5 and 10. And you've got to be careful. We don't just do the kind of procedure way of doing it and just go add a 5, 10 like this, because we know that wouldn't work with a function. I wouldn't see anything and I actually want to have it printed out. So what I need to do, as silly as it does seem potentially, is have a variable. Let's call it, it says total in the question. Doesn't matter what it's called really. Total equals, and then I do the calling bit. I put in my parameter values, 5, 10. And now the result will get saved to total. I can then print total, and that covers this question. A slightly trickier example is this one. We're writing a function called howManyOdd that asks the user to enter 5 numbers. It will then return how many of these numbers were odd. Call this function and then print out the resulting number. Before you start, it's worth doing a bit of planning in your head. This could be, I don't know, between 6 and 8 marks, maybe a little bit more. How would you go about this question? Well, to get the user to enter 5 numbers, we should not just be having 5 input lines. We should be having a for loop here to do this efficiently. You might be thinking to yourself, do I need parameters here? Well, it doesn't mention any parameters, and we're asking the user for this. So therefore my input is coming from the user and not from parameters. And it's definitely a function, it says function, but also you have a word return. Now, in terms of planning again, how would I determine if a number is odd? Well, we can tell if a number is odd if the number mod 2 is equal to 1. That is our standard way of checking if a number is odd. To check if a number is even, it's exactly the same. It would be num mod 2 is equal to 0. Why is this the case? Well, for odd numbers at least, if I had 7, like 7 is an odd number, 7 mod 2 is doing 7 divided by 2. 7 divided by 2 is 3, remainder 1. So mod gives us a remainder, therefore it's odd because it has got a remainder of 1. So let's package this into a nice function. Start with a word function. We've got our identifier, how many odd. No parameters needed, we've decided, because we're getting input instead. So we don't want to just have the user do this 5 separate times. We want to use a for loop. Let's do a for loop for I is equal to 0 to 4. This for loop will repeat 5 times in total. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. It's 5 in total. And then inside the for loop, we're going to ask the user to enter a number. Now we need to check to see if that number is odd or not. Well, I need to package this expression into an if statement. If num mod 2 is equal to 1, therefore it must be odd. That means it's odd. So what should I do now? Well, I'm being asked to output how many were odd. So therefore I need to keep track of how many I've got. So really I need to have a counter variable to do this, which I've not done so far. We always need to, if I want to do a line like, let's do count equals count plus 1. Well, to do a line like that, I've got to make sure I've got an initial value of count, because the first time this runs, it's going the new value of count should be the old value of count plus 1. Well, there is no old value of count currently. Count is not mentioned anywhere in my program. So that's why I would need to put in a count equals 0 line above my for loop. Really, really common to forget that. Totally forget it, but also really common to only realize that midway through. Yeah, the planner can help identify it, but it's also fine just to kind of squeeze it in if you need to, because that's pretty common. Now, that's kind of the only thing I'm checking for. I could end if at that point, and I can, you know, end my for loop actually as well, because I need to make sure I go through each of these 5 numbers inputted, check if it's odd. If it is, add 1 to the count and move on to the next number entered. And when all of that is done, the value of count should be how many odd numbers I had in this program. So at that point, I can just return it. I'm done. I need to output it. I'm not printing. Procedures typically will just print. Functions typically don't print at all, but they definitely have to have return. We can return count in this case. And then I can end function. And lastly, we need to call this function and then print out the resulting number. So this kind of two-step process. We need to be like result equals how many odd. Got no parameters, so my bracket stays empty. I can just about squeeze in this last line. We're just going to print out result and show that to the user. We don't know what this answer is going to be because it relies on user input. This code should work if the user typed in five numbers.